In 1908, there was a great automobile race from New York City to Paris. If you're thinking that's insane and impossible because of, you know, the ocean, you're right. But it happened, and there was a winner. And everything that went down during the great auto race from New York to Paris is at least three times as insane as you're imagining. The proposed route of the race took the drivers westward across the United States, including through areas with very few paved roads, which was most areas. The race was in 1908. Asphalt wasn't even invented until 1910. After making it across the United States, the drivers would head north through Canada, make a left turn into Alaska, and then make a beeline for the Bering Strait, which separates America from Russia. The race's organizers started the race in the middle of winter, hoping that the Bering Strait would be frozen at that time, making it possible for the drivers to just, you know, drive straight from Alaska to Russia, across the frozen ocean. After that, the course then led through Siberia, which no one had ever traveled by car, before finally reaching Moscow, St. Petersburg, on to Berlin, and then finally, 22,000 miles away from Times Square, Paris. The race began in Times Square on February 12, 1908, smack dab in the middle of winter. There were six cars set to race, three cars from France, one from Germany, one from Italy, and one from the United States. Each car wasn't just one man behind the wheel, it was a team of men, which was necessary to keep the cars operating. Remember, this is 1908, and it's the middle of winter, and these cars aren't really cars as we think of them today. They're more like horseless carriages. They didn't have hard roofs, there were no windshields. A quarter of a million people lined the streets of New York to see the drivers off, most notably the American crew and their automobile, the 60-horsepower Thomas Flyer, piloted by fan favorite Monty Roberts and George Schuster, who was a mechanic employed by the E.R. Thomas Motor Company, the same company, obviously, that had manufactured the Thomas Flyer. The race was supposed to start at 11 a.m., with Mayor George B. McClellan Jr. firing off the starting pistol, but he never showed up, so at 11:15, a railroad financier named Colgate Hoyt just grabbed the pistol and got the race started himself. This messy start was certainly a sign of things to come. After 96 miles, one of the French cars dropped out of the race with a broken differential. Near Hudson, New York, the remaining cars did their best to move through foot-deep snow in a single-file line, with each car's mechanic basically walking beside the vehicle, checking the depth of snowdrifts, and laying down planks for the cars to get traction. While trekking through the snow on either terrible roads or, more often, no road at all, hiking to hardware stores to fill up on gasoline one bucketful at a time, the teams worked out a gentleman's agreement, even though they were racing, that they would rotate who was in the lead every 5 hours. However, it didn't take too long for that gentleman's agreement to explode when, perhaps brought to the brink of insanity by the hardships of the road, everyone just started accusing one another of cheating. The Italians accused the Americans of cheating by using railroad tracks and the aid of a trolley car, even though the Italians, and everyone else, had been using bands of horses to pull their cars from time to time. In Indiana, most of the foreign teams complained about having to pay a higher price than the Americans to enlist the help of locals and their horses, and thought that the American people were giving an unfair advantage to the crew of the Thomas Flyer. And, of course, they were. By March 8th, 1 month after the race had started, the pack of autos reached Colorado with the Thomas Flyer leading the way. However, the crew of the Thomas Flyer was looking a bit different. Specifically, Hans Hendrik Hansen, who was originally on the crew of the Dion, one of the French cars, was now riding with Schuster and Monty Roberts in the American Thomas Flyer. Turns out he had gotten into an argument with the French driver of the Dion, and they nearly had a duel about it. A duel with pistols. Instead of possibly being shot in the head, Hansen pledged allegiance to the American flag and hopped into the Thomas Flyer. Soon after that, Monty Roberts, the fan favorite driver of the Thomas Flyer, decided to leave the race in Wyoming, leaving Schuster, the unsung hero mechanic, in full control of the American car. Around that same time, the Motobloc, another French car in the race, was having such mechanical trouble, the car's driver decided to sneakily ship the car via train to San Francisco. But he was caught by a news photographer trying to load the car onto the train, and so he just decided to quit the race instead of face the shame of being a terrible cheater. So now, out of the original six, four cars were left in the race, and they were barely out of the American Midwest, on their journey to Paris from New York City. The Thomas Flyer made its way from the Midwest to Utah, cut through Nevada and around the border of Death Valley, and then finally arrived in San Francisco in the middle of March. At this point, the Americans were 900 miles ahead of their closest competitor, the Italian team in their car, the Zust. At the time, just making it from New York to San Fran with basically no roads to speak of was a remarkable feat in and of itself. But of course, the Thomas Flyer had its sights set on Alaska and driving across the frozen Bering Strait to make its way to Russia. On April 8th, the Thomas Flyer reached Valdez, Alaska, much to the astonishment of the locals who had never in their lives seen one of them dare newfangled automobiles. Once there, the hero mechanic Schuster took a one-horse sleigh to investigate the trail they were meant to drive on to get to the Bering Strait. What he found was that the only way a car was making it through Alaska was if they dismantled it and shipped the parts by dog sled. With that report, the Paris newspaper that was sponsoring the whole race decided that the whole Bering Strait idea was off. And also, in what was similarly problematic, the Bering Strait doesn't actually freeze over. So, you can't drive on it. Because it's the ocean. The new official plan was for the cars to be shipped across the Pacific from Seattle. Now, the other cars never made it as far as Alaska. They just went straight to Seattle and jumped right on a ship and set sail. So, even though the Americans were the first to reach the Pacific and were the only car to actually make it to Alaska, they were the last to leave the continent. But everyone realized how unfair that was, so while the French and Italian teams were busy ripping through Japan on their way to Russia, the race committee made the decision that since the Thomas Flyer had done better than anyone else, they awarded them an automatic 15-day lead in the race. So any other car could beat the Americans to Paris by 2 weeks and still lose. Despite the confusion, despite not being able to drive across the ocean, eventually by train, trail, horse, boat, and willpower, the remaining four cars all made it to Russia. Once they got to Russia, the racers were told they should just give up and take the newly made Trans-Siberian Railroad. One of the Italian racers reported that they were told about things they would encounter by men from the Russian government. They said, quote, "We shall be met on the road by Chinese brigands, Manchurian tigers, fever, plague, pestilence, famine, to say nothing of the mud after 3 months of rain, mosquitoes as big as locusts, and other similar delights." All of that is likely made up, but Russia was no cakewalk. Other than the narrow path carved by the Trans-Siberian Railroad, there were no roads or trails to follow, just the unforgiving frozen tundra and swamps, which cars kept falling into and needed to constantly be pulled to safety. Shortly after arriving in Russia, the French Didion called it quits. So we were down to the American Thomas Flyer, the Italian Zust, and the German Protos. While in Perm, Russia, after a wrong turn that cost them 15 hours, and after finally getting out of a muddy sinkhole they had fallen into, Schuster and the crew of the Thomas Flyer were informed that Monty Roberts would be joining back up with them to finish the race in Europe. After all, he was the handsome fan favorite the fans wanted to see cross the finish line in Paris. And more importantly, Monty Roberts driving the Thomas Flyer was the image the Thomas Car Company wanted, so that they could sell cars to rich people after the race was through. People want to drive the same car as handsome heroes. They don't want to drive the same car a mechanic drives. This obviously upset Schuster, the man who took the car from the American Midwest up to Alaska, across the ocean and through Siberia while Monty slept at home in a warm bed, so basically he said, absolutely not, and he finished the race without Monty. At 6:15 p.m. on Sunday, July 26th, 5.5 months and 21,933 miles from the start in Times Square, Lieutenant Copen and the German car, the Protos, arrived in Paris. Though they arrived first, the huge celebration was saved for Schuster and the American crew of the Thomas Flyer when they arrived 4 days later. Because of their 15-day allowance, they were the winners. But before they crossed the finish line, there was one more bump in the road. After traveling nearly 22,000 miles with the finish line in their sights, French police placed them under arrest for not having headlights on their car. Seriously, that really happened. But the day was saved when a Parisian placed his bicycle, which had a headlight on it, into the front seat of the Thomas Flyer, which is basically the most French thing anyone could do, but the cops were cool with it. They considered the Thomas Flyer to now have headlights and allowed it to proceed to the finish line. At long last, the great race from New York to Paris was complete. For his incredible feat, Schuster was given full-time employment at the Thomas Motor Company factory as a mechanic for as long as the company was in business, which ended up being 5 more years until they shut down and all their stuff was auctioned off. Though it didn't lead to fame and fortune, the race did succeed in selling cars in the short term for the Thomas Motor Company, And more importantly, it made people see the automobile as a hardy, dependable means of transport and ushered in the construction of better, safer roads all across the continental United States.
Thanks for watching this video. Be sure to like this video and subscribe to this channel for more of history's weirdness that you won't find in your textbooks. All those textbooks that you had to give back. No one has their textbooks anymore, right? I don't have mine. Anyway, there's this video here. There's this one here. There's more stuff here. There's more good stuff. If you liked it, stick around.